Right, right. Musical chairs.
Who's playing the music?
Welcome, one and all. This is our last legacy of the day. We all must agree it's been quite a ride so far up until right now. Wow. And now some of the best storytellers of all time on stage right here and now. Otis can't wait. Tom, this is your guy. These are your guys. You take the lead, my friend. Greatest team in NFL history.
I thought you said me take over, and you started talking to get in the mic. You know, I think, what do we got to go to the elder statesman here of this group? We got Emory Moorhead. I always say Emory Moorhead's a wide receiver that ate himself into a tight end.
And a longer career. Hey, it's great to see you all. This place is packed, and we love it. We love you guys.
It's unreal.
Great.
Big O, what's your feeling of the weekend, the support of the Bears fans, your Bear career, everything?
It is always a pleasure to see the Bear fans come out. I mean, coming down off the Kennedy and seeing all the fans, but most of all, to sit here and see these guys. I love the point of my life when I get to be around them. I mean, I have so much love for them and so many great stories, and it's just an honor and a pleasure to be here.
You know, we just sat up here and Dan Hampton was talking about how much he enjoyed being a teammate of William Perry, a guy that came in and lit up our locker room every day. Fridge, you got an opportunity to come back to Chicago about some of the fun you had with the Bears, both as a defensive tackle and a running back of your time. That had to be a lot of fun for you to be able to join the Bears at such an important time.
Go ahead, Doc.
I was just saying, just some of the enjoyment you've had here in Chicago, some of the fun from being a defensive tackle all the way to one of the first big man running backs, because last year Matt Nagy had a play where he gave Akeem Hicks the ball for a touchdown, and he called it the freezer. In salute to the fridge, William Perry.
Yeah, you know, it was great. It was great and everything. And, you know, I couldn't say anything, you know, saying no more. Everything was wonderful. And I enjoyed it. And it's, you know, it was fun, you know, doing it for the people and enjoying myself.
There you go. Catching the ball.
Willie, the instigator of the Super Bowl shuffle.
Yes.
Kind of a gutsy move to do it on the plane after we lost our first game that season. Did you ever think about taking a step back and maybe giving that loss a little bit of time to warm up, or were you full speed ready to go?
No, I was pretty confident. You know, I think the loss for us sort of put us in perspective. I think we knew we were good, but we knew if we didn't play together as a team that we wouldn't win. So that day was pretty trying because everything was set up to do the video, and I had the dubious task of trying to convince these guys after we had lost in Miami to come the next day and shoot the video. So I talked to Mike Singletary, and Mike said, okay, we've already committed. Let's do it as a team. Let's let this be a team building for us. So we decided to get together as a team at that video and make sure that we committed to each other that we were going to go out and play our best, and that's what happened, and of course, the rest is history.
Richard, when you look back on it all, not surprised where you are, but are you impressed with everything you've been able to accomplish and achieve since you weren't the highest draft choice? You were able to do what Buddy Ryan wanted to get out of you. You know, you had to play the run, you had to rush the passer, and then you sit here today as a Hall of Famer. I think all the fans are equally as impressed as we are.
Well, you know, on the road to the pro standards coming out of Tennessee State, most people, guys that get drafted, they worried about where they're getting drafted, what they're doing. You know, the point of it is that when you get into the league and you get drafted, you're getting more money than what you had when you walked in the door. So there's no reason to be upset about where you being placed. You're getting an opportunity, you're getting a platform to show what you're worth and show what you could do. And, after coming to Chicago Bears and meeting, seeing some of the guys, they didn't know much about me. I didn't know much about them, but we seemed to find ourselves. I didn't understand why I wasn't playing, but, you know, Buddy had a problem, and I had a problem with not taking the trap on well. So when we move a lot, which is I really appreciate it, so when Fridge is over the center, I got to, you know, spill the play with my right shoulder. So, but when he's over the guard, I can squeeze it. So I had a minute trying to get that together, and finally I got that together, then, you know, I was in the starting lineup. So, you know, but I could understand. I did not understand, but I did later, and eventually, you know, as a kid, you know, you dream to do some things, and every dream that I imagined as a kid to play football in the National Football League, everything that has happened, except the Hall of Fame, which I didn't know anything about the Hall of Fame during that time, but I seen myself do what was done in my career. You know, if you can dream it, that means God is blessing you. You have to, once you pray about it, you have to be about it. And with the players that I had in my, around me, you know, it was all about the opportunity. You know, I don't miss the game. I miss the guys that I played with.
Like all of us. Jay, you kind of had a unique journey here. You're an undrafted free agent out of Iowa. You became a seven-time Pro Bowler, but you were raised in the National Football League. Your Uncle Wally played 16 years in the NFL. Your dad played football. Your younger brother, Joel, played 10 or 11 years with the New Orleans Saints. Was it Bill McGrain that kind of got you attached to the Bears and gave you your opportunity?
Yes, it was really, it was, you know, the Bears organization, and Jim Finks was with Chicago at the time, the general manager. He used to be with the Minnesota Vikings, and as you said, my uncle played with the Vikings, and when Finks knew Wally Hilgenberg, my uncle played up there, and as you said, I met Buddy Ryan as when I was a sophomore in high school. As he was Wally's position coach, and going up to the Minnesota practices and camps. So I knew Buddy then, and I went to Super Bowl IX, and I remember my uncle Wally was a roommate of Alan Page, and I went up to the room to talk to Wally, and he wasn't there, but I sat in the room, and Alan talked to me for like 20 minutes. I'm a sophomore in high school, about, you know, the sports I was into, and he was just really, he took a 20 minutes of his time to really spend time with me. And then my rookie year, you know, being undrafted, coming to Chicago and trying to make a name for myself, there I am practicing against Alan Page every day for that first season, and he really worked with me that year. So, you know, I didn't come into the NFL the way I thought I was going to arrive, but I was so lucky. You know, I get Jim Finks and Bill McGrain, you know, Hall of Fame Jim Finks. I come to the Chicago Bears there. I'm coached by Mike Ditka, who's a Hall of Fame offensive line coach, Hall of Fame Dick Stanfill. I practice against, you know, Dan Hampton, Hall of Fame, Mike Singletary, Hall of Fame. Steve McMichael should be in the Hall of Fame. It goes on and on. And then when Fridge came to the Chicago Bears, he really changed what it meant to go out there and practice that day, because his arrival, because I knew when they drafted Fridge and I saw his highlights in college and what I was going to have to go through that training camp. I mean, I got myself ready in 85 to play, not the opponents, because I knew Fridge was coming to Chicago. And boy, I was happy that the Fridge was the Chicago Bears, and I didn't have to play him on any other team.
But, you know, we all hear from the defensive players how difficult it was for them to earn the respect of Buddy Ryan. So you meet Buddy Ryan as a kid. How did he treat you when he came to Chicago?
Oh, it was like yesterday. I remember the very first day of practice out in the field. We had Cals, and we broke down to Cals. And being the rookie free agent, I couldn't even go with the defense the first period of practice. I couldn't go with the offense. I had to go with the defense and sit there and snap the ball for you guys coming off the ball. And I go running up to the defensive drill, and there's Buddy standing there. He looks at me, and he goes, "Where's the ball, Rook?" And I go, "What are you talking about?" He goes, "Hey, every good center has a football in his hand." He goes, "You never know when a game's going to break out." And right that day, from that day forward, my whole career, I never stepped on the football field without a football in my hand. Always had a football in my hand.
Jay, you also have talked about how quick William was off the ball.
Yeah, that's something that, you know, Tom and I both really studied a lot of game tape. I first learned that from Noah Jackson. My rookie year in the NFL, we used to have the film projector, and the rookies had to carry the projector on the flights and travel and carry it and bring it to the meetings and set it up. And Noah always liked watching tape before he went to bed at night. So I'd go up there to get the projector, and I'd sit down and watch tape with him. And Noah really taught me what he was looking at. He would get up there and start diagram. You know, you got to be like a boxer. You got to snap, and you got to be able to hit the guy and not give him all your body weight. So he taught me. I learned a lot from Noah, you know, with that projector there. And I just think a guy like that should be recognized an awful lot.
Jim Finks did a wonderful job. The 83 draft. I can't imagine there's anyone better in NFL history. I mean, look what it gave you guys. Okay, Otis was already here. Emery, you were here. Walter was here. McMahon was here. Hamp was here. But then you bring in that 83 class with Jimbo and Willie and Tom and Richard as a later round pick.
It's a great class.
Dewerson. I mean, Bortz. I mean, keep coming.
Mike Richardson.
Yeah. Kenan.
Bortz. L.A.
How much respect for Jim Finks?
Well, I would say there's a lot of respect for him because I would say he probably orchestrated along with the scouting staff, you know, and putting the pieces to the puzzle together. I mean, to understand what you need and to go out there and get what you need, he was no doubt about it, an important part of that.
My experience with Jim Finks was a little different. I came to the Bears. Denver had cut me. The Bears picked me up. And I went through the preseason. And then the very last cut, Noah Jackson was holding out. And they signed Noah. And they cut me at the game of the last, before the game. And anyway, I finished that year. Then the next year, they fired Neil Armstrong. And they hired Mike Ditka. And they brought Mike in, and they moved me to tight end. And so I had a great year. The first, I was playing at 215 pounds at tight end. So it was easily getting away from all the linebackers and the safeties. And with play action to Walter, it was just unbelievably easy. But anyway, after the season, in fact, Virginia might remember this, they said they were going to sign me to a new contract. And Ed said, we're going to sign you to a new contract, and me for having a great year. So I come in, I sign the contract, and Jim Finks is also there. And he goes, Emery, he says, come back here, I want to talk to you. And he says, Emery, he says, he lived in Winnetka, and he had a maid by the name of Mrs. Robinson that went to the same church I did in Evanston. And he said, Emery, he said, Miss Robinson been telling me for 5 years to sign you. And he says, now we're finally going to sign you to a nice contract. So I got to the Bears through Ms. Robinson pestering him every year, sign Emery. And that's how I ended up getting a nice contract out of the Bears.
All roads lead to the NFL, Emery, yeah, right? Yeah. All roads lead to the NFL.
Yeah.
William, when it was all going on your rookie year, you just loved playing. Did you realize what was going on, becoming a national and international sensation because of your popularity? Did you recognize it, or were you just all about ball?
Oh, well, when I came in, Bears drafted me, and I'm playing defensive tackle. I didn't ever think I was going to be a fullback, you know, lining up in the backfield. And he surprised me because when San Francisco did it against them, then he got me and stuck me in the backfield so he can rub it in his face and everything. So, you know, it was great, and I loved it, and it was fun.
Yeah. I'll tell you another story about Fridge. That year, we were after the Super Bowl. Jeff Fisher, Steve Fuller, and I go on a ski trip with a bunch of fans over to Switzerland. And so we go over there, and of course we're the big guys, and everybody's like, "Who are these guys?" And I say, "No, I play football." And I said, "Chicago Bears." They still didn't know. And I said, Walter Payton, and I didn't know. And I said, the Fridge. They went, oh, yeah, we know the Bears. We know the Bears.
You know, it's kind of reason, you know, when you, this event, so there's people here from all 50 states and 7 different countries. And when you have a personality like Fridge and Walter Payton, these guys, that's why the popularity outreaches just the Chicagoland, Illinois area, and it is a worldwide phenomenon.
I actually, when I first saw Fridge, I was watching TV, and he had this short shirt on, when didn't have much of a gut, but I watched how he was, you know, working the field from sideline to sideline, and I said, this guy can move. And finally, then he's end up in Chicago, and, you know, he's running the ball for a while. But once he got in the starting lineup, you know, it was tough to block him one-on-one. So I said, what a great guy is right beside me. I'm beside him. I said, so what we're going to do, we're going to dictate on this side. We're going to tell people what they can do and what they can't do, right? So William, I'll tell Williams and William, I'm not going to stick my nose in your business. You don't stick your nose in my business, but what I need you to do is when the ball come my way, run to the numbers. If the ball go past the numbers, stop running. I got it, right? And if the ball goes inside, I'm not going to rush in there because I got him in there, I got Steve in there, I got Singleton, all these different people. So, you know, I was taught a lot about playing football in a way of take two things away and play the other. You see, now you're dictating about what's going to take place. So we knew nobody's going to run the ball on our side. We knew we was going to make the ball go the other way, and it was all about when they try to trick you and reverse and back. But when you can play with people like that, that working hand in hand and really controlling the whole game where I can have fun because I know what you can do and I know what you can't do. Now, you may try it, but, you know, I figure if you give me the ball enough, we're going to get a turnover, we're going to do some things. But I appreciate this man so much playing beside him, and that's why, you know, a guy like Otis Wilson also should be in the Hall of Fame. Also, Wilbert Marshall. I play with a lot of guys, and Jimbo Colbert, you know, and Jay Hilgenberg. We had so many great ball players, and it was just so much fun. We didn't realize how much fun that we was having. But, you know, that's what you miss, the guys that you play with.
And then to really add on to that, it was a great thing. And knowing Buddy Ryan's system, you know, Buddy had an attack system. And like Richard was saying, we knew if we took care of a certain area. See, I'm on the all the way on the other side with Dan Hampton.
We're sending them your way.
Exactly. Right. And I was trying to send them his way. And I knew, I said, nothing's gonna come out from the numbers to the sideline. I got that covered. I'm pushing everything back in. And then Hampton's over there, you know, Fridge in the middle. And him and Singleton say, where you gonna go? There's nowhere to go. You know, so it was just so much. I would always say, I'm not gonna let Hampton down. Hampton said, I'm not going to let Fridge down. Fridge, we knew what Richard was going to do. See, that we called Richard the Colonel. And the Colonel meaning like Kentucky Fried Chicken. At one time, they only sold chicken. We knew what he was going to do.
We're going to get up field,
so we
baby.
Said, we're going to let him handle that.
We're going to get up field, without a doubt.
But, exactly. Stay up field.
You know, but what we really appreciate about Buddy and to me is as a player, like, you know, people talk about Peyton Manning making calls on the line of scrimmage, how smart and great he is. Well, hell, those other guys gotta be smart too, right? Because if they don't know what's going on, you know, ain't nothing going on. So in defense, we did the same thing. You know, I look at Buddy, he pat his hand, I know that's automatic front control, you know? So we didn't never get a call until third down, but on first and second down, we play what we see. If you get in an I formation, we did something. You did in red, whatever formation. So the point of it is, what I appreciate, he gave us the game. Now, some coaches don't want to give the game. Some coaches like to get off on what they do. But if you don't have players, you're just getting off yourself. You're not getting anywhere. So the point of it, you have to make the players be responsible for their action. If you make them be responsible, they're going to play harder, they're going to do more, you know. But if you're just making a call, make a call. I would say, hey, coach, I got two on me, just send one. Just try to get us one-on-one, not send someone free, because now we're getting everybody going. So it's a math game, football is. You got five linemen that's going to have to block four, or you're going to have six going to have to block four. Sooner or later, it's going to work out in your way.
You know, Emery, Willie, and Jay.
This is funny, though.
I was going to say.
This is funny. Oh, this is funny. This is indicative of our team. So many of you guys may not know, our offense was ranked number two in the league that year, right? But we had such an amazing defense, was ranked number one in the country, the best defense ever. But our offense, we would just sit back and do our thing, and we give them the ball. But we were ranked number two in the entire league, but people don't know that because we had such a great defense.
Well, if they were fortunate, they always got to play fresh because we held onto the ball for 36 minutes.
They only had to play 20 minutes.
We had Walter Payton, we had Jim McMahon, we had, you know, all these guys.
All right, you know, Richard, you only had to play 20 minutes a game because we controlled the ball the whole game.
Now you take the special teams out of it, they was really
exactly,
only playing 16
right.
minutes a game.
Right. I mean, the offense led
That's
the NFL in first downs. The offense led the NFL in scoring that year. Yeah. I mean, there's a ton of things.
Rushing the football.
Ball control. Yeah.
Ball control.
When y'all didn't do anything, we come off and say, hey, guys.
We controlled the ball. We led the NFL in first downs. I mean, see, the only problem is that, you know, when you get tired as an offensive player, you can't sit there on the sideline and cheer for the other team's offense because, you know, you want to rest on the bench. That's why defense can verbally be on the offense because you guys get tired and you're getting mad at us because we're going three and out. We can't get mad at you guys for going three and out.
Well, while they was going three and out, we were telling them, the funny thing that he didn't mention, they always got the ball on the 35-yard line.
Right.
The team never came past the 50 on
right.
us. And we
that
was always three and out. You should be number one.
We love you guys.
You should be number one.
We love you guys. I mean,
You're right. Should be number one. And we used to say, you know, just to piss them off, we was like, hey, guys, just hold them. You know, get a first down, hold them, we'll come back, we'll score.
You know
okay?
what? This seems like the same stories that we just had from the 63 group. The 63 group said, oh, our defense was so great, we just asked for the defense. Just hold them.
Looked at 9 points. We said, you know, we can't give anybody no more than 9 points. Because we knew that we could turn over, we could score, or we get a turnover, get a field goal. So we know if we got 10 points, it's going to be a problem. You know?
It was such a pleasure just to watch those guys. I mean, as I sat down and watched our defense play the other team, I was at awe. I mean, it was, like, amazing to see what they did, how they performed, the professionalism they had, and also the excitement they had. I mean, these guys were excited to hit people. You can't be that excited today because, you know, you can't do as much as we did back then. But it was really amazing.
Willie, see what you started? And you know what? See what you started? You see what you started? I was thinking it, too. I was thinking it, too. Because they will talk all day about that defense.
Yeah. What we're missing on this panel is Mike Richardson to do some chirping at this defensive line. Because they always complaining y'all didn't get enough pressure for them.
He got them deep, touchdowns and interceptions.
No, our defense was great. And one thing, you know, Buddy was a guy, until you made a play, he didn't even talk to you. He'd call you by your number, whatever. And he would come by to the offense right before the game. He'd say, you get me 10 points. He says, I'll let the dogs loose. And he said, we'll crush them.
Buddy, I mean, what I enjoyed about Buddy on Mondays after the game, I can remember the championship game and the Giants flipped the tight end and started putting him on my side. And Buddy would always say, get a hit on the tight end, get a hit on him. I said, okay, I'm going to get a hit on him. Playoff game. So I get a hit on him, and now Hampton upfield, my tackle upfield, I can go back outside. I'm looking at the quarterback down the middle. I'm saying, I see ball, get ball. Do I need to go back this? So Buddy's like, what's going on out there, coach? We seeing ball, we get ball. We'll talk about it on Monday, right? Like, I don't know what y'all doing, but hey, we see that ball. I see it, I'm gonna get it. I'm not gonna go all the way back outside while I'm inside pushing the tight end down, but I enjoyed his meetings, you know, in the meetings and what he was calling people. You know, with bad plays, good plays, but we always played as a team on defense to beat to beat the other positions. So the defensive line would have the best grades, the linebackers, so on, with the corners and safeties. And then we start having individual plays. So, you know, it's I'm a small guy from a small school. Here I got, you know, Tom over there, went to Notre Dame, you know. It's like, and so I may have a guy at Notre Dame or from some big school, and they say, oh, you got a post. No, I ain't got a post. That guy, you know, he come from a big school. I'm a small, you know, I'm a small school guy. So it was fun to have this camaraderie that we used to have on Mondays. You know, it was always something to look forward to on Mondays.
You know what? We never look forward to Mondays.
Right, exactly.
Because you got Ditka running the projector, and I always say you could tell how well you played by the sweat rings underneath your armpits, because it was never pleasant, and you watched every play probably five or six times.
Right. You know, Sundays really, I mean, you go through the week of practice as an offensive lineman, you know, against this defense. That was a tough week. The game Sunday, you know, that was kind of a break. Monday was actually the worst day. He's going over the review with Mike Ditka running that projector. I mean, he critiqued us heavily. It was always like the game, you know, after the game, you'd have a nice win. You want to come in and see some nice plays, the replay, and coach would come in there and go, all right, guys, we're in a hurry today. We can't tell you good job. We're just going to go correct what's wrong in this film.
Right. I mean, we got to run for Buddy, and we got to run for Ditka. So we made a pledge with Buddy that, look, Buddy, if we don't lose anymore, we don't run the ladder, we don't run the shuttle. Exactly. You remember that? And Buddy said, yeah, okay, great, because, you know, we got to run, then we got to do walkthroughs. So Buddy wants you to be like what you be in the game, tired, try and make decisions, checkpoint. And yet then Ditka wants to run us. So, you know, defensive-wise, we're running a whole lot. So we made this bet, and we said we're not losing anymore because we don't run that ladder anymore.
What happened after the Miami game?
Nothing happened at the Miami game. We was looking for Miami to show up, but, you know, Miami couldn't show up. But, you know, that game, I think that, you know, they had – I was tripping over all kind of things. I don't know, ghosties out there or whatever they was – but, you know, they – I think what they did, they spread us out. They did half roll to get rid of the ball quick, right? And at that time, you know, Buddy and Mike was fighting on the sideline at halftime because Buddy was putting more people on the line of scrimmage. Mike was trying to throw the ball – like the Miami Dolphins. And, you know, you look at the Dolphins was 28th in stopping the run. So it was like, why are we out here trying to throw the ball? And Dick is getting that Buddy, like, why are you putting everybody on the line of scrimmage? You know, so, you know, you got two head coaches there and there was a little fight going on, but we could use the loss. We wasn't thinking about being undefeated. But after that game, we looked at coming into that game, we had an opportunity to be undefeated. And some of the guys thought maybe we should go down there and practice, get used to the weather. And, you know, Buddy came up with it. So says, let's talk to Mike. We said, this ain't going to happen. If Buddy coming up with it, asking Mike. If Mike would have came up with it, we probably would have went. But the point of it is that we was looking forward to seeing Miami show up again. They just couldn't show up.
And to add to that, Mark Clayton, you know, he's a Louisville guy. And
yeah.
Can't think of
Duper.
Duper, yeah.
Mark Duper. No, Mark Clayton.
Yeah.
But they were Nat Moore. That's the name. That's the name I'm talking about. Nat Moore has a golf outing, so I go to the golf outing. So they figure they give me a little information on how they won that football game. They seem to think the fact that when Buddy left Wilbur in, the take care of that slot guy, whoever he was, sometimes he was Duper. Sometimes it was Clayton, that they was going to exploit that and take advantage of that. And that's what they tried to do. So, you know, Richard, you know, hit it on the head. You don't win every football game. We figured they beat us and we get an opportunity, hopefully, to get back at them, but they couldn't get through New England. So 18-1 wasn't bad.
I'm kind of glad they didn't show up because, you know, I love Jimbo and I told – when I went to the Pro Bowl, Jimbo told me, hey, take it easy on Danny. I said, okay, Jimbo, I'll do that, you know. So I went and hit him. I said, you know, that one's on Jimbo, okay? The next one's on me, right? So, you know, if they would have showed up, it would have been, pretty ugly, guys. I don't know, you know, because we really look forward to seeing those guys in the Super Bowl, but they didn't make it.
So he had the great running game.
your impact in the speed department to help stretch the field. How critical was that, honestly, to the Bears' offense?
Well, as a speed guy, there's very few things that I can control as a receiver. I can't control the play being called. I can't control the defense. I can't control the quarterback throwing the ball or the lineman blocking. The only thing I can control is me being in shape, knowing my plays, and doing my best. So I tried to make sure that I was the fastest guy on the field at all time, in better shape than everyone else. I always ran extra. I ran with these guys extra after practice. So every time I stepped on the field, I was the fastest guy, and I was in better shape than anyone else on the field. That's what I can control. So
you're probably still the fastest shape,
yeah, right? Yeah, exactly. So I think as a receiver, you look at that and you make your contribution. I was very pleased at what I was able to do. I mean, I had a great running back. We had a great running back named Walter Payton. So we didn't throw the ball a lot. I led my team, you know, all 5 years I was here in receiving and yardage. So I think I contributed as much as I could. I ran fast. I cleared out for other guys. You know, we play unselfishly, really. I think, and today it's a little bit different because everybody's about me. But I sometimes would get one or two passes thrown to me a game, but that was part of the game. I ran, cleared out for Dennis, cleared out for Emery. If I didn't do my job, they didn't get catches. So I think it was important to do that from an unselfish standpoint. You know, Chicago, right. Look, I've been around the world, and Chicago is probably the best city in the world for me. It has an amazing city. And I'm not just saying that because I'm here. I say that everywhere I go. Chicago made an amazing impact on my life, and it's the best city in America. It just gets too cold. You didn't have the weather, I think it would be too many people here. But it's a great city, great fans, great people, and it's definitely a Chicago Bear town. I thank Coach Hallis for giving me the opportunity to play here. You know, he gave the reins to Jim Finks to draft people and to bring the right players in. I think it was a vision of his to see that, and of course it's carried on through his daughter and their his grandkids. So it's a great organization, a great city, and I was very pleased to be a part of it for 5 years and be a part of something like this that you can never, never, ever forget, and it'll always be a part of my life. Like Richard said, you forget, you miss the playing with the guys, you miss the locker room, you miss the trips. And those are the things that I'll keep with me forever.
And we all miss... And we all miss Walter Payton, so across the board, let's talk Walter, because we didn't have the ability to have, obviously, a seminar and a discussion with all the great backs. Right. Tom and Jay, you blocked for them. You're in that huddle. Emery, Willie, Richard, you and Otis, great friends with them. Let's talk Walter, everybody. We'll start with Tommy.
You know, it was weird for me because I was in awe of Walter. I was more of a fan of his than a teammate. And because you grow up in the area and you know that the Bears went through some lean years, but there was always greatness in Walter Payton. So when you had the chance to come in here and be an offensive lineman for him and be on the same team, you just wanted to meet his approval, just like you did with Ditka and just like you did with Dick Stanfeld, our offensive line coach. You felt if you could meet their approval, then you were kind of on the road to doing something special.
Well, I mean, obviously you guys blocked for him. My experience with Walter was, you know, on every Tuesdays was our day off. So we would go hunting. It was Roland Harper, myself and Walter, and you know, me coming from Brooklyn, New York, I know nothing about outdoor life and hunting and woods and all that stuff. So obviously he had to tell me what to go buy. And, you know, I got all my fatigues, the green stuff, and got my over and under rifle, and we went bird hunting. We would hit pheasant hunting. So we had a chance to really sit down and really get to know somebody. I think we were right up there by you, Jay. It's a place called Twin Willow Pheasant Farm. We used to go up there right there in Kenosha.
Absolutely.
And we go up there and just spend the whole day, you know, shooting birds, and then they give you the birds and you go home and cook them, but
they're expensive,
you know, everybody knows Walter as a great, great football player. But Walter was the coolest guy that I knew. I mean, always had a smile on his face. He never said anything derogatory about somebody. I mean, he shit everything he had. That's the great thing about it. You know, he had all of the nightclubs in Schaumburg. So when we win a football game, we go to the restaurant or the club, and we just have carte blanche. If you want to drive fast cars, you can take one of his cars. And I mean, it was just great spending 7 years playing with him. And the only thing I didn't like about Walter was when he went and worked out on this hill. Over in Arlington Heights, he had this huge hill. And I figured, you know, 6'3½", 245, in shape, I'm gonna run up this hill more than Walter. After about the third time, I went up this hill and came back down, I never saw that hill again. I mean, and he would run up and down this hill like it was nothing. And then I said, well, okay, I see you gotta pace yourself. So from that point on, I started pacing myself. But a great individual, a great athlete, a good family man, you can't say nothing bad about Walter.
Yeah, Walter was a phenomenal athlete and a great person. And like Tom said, coming from Evanston, you know, you've heard about Walter. I played 4 years before I got to play with Walter. And when I came here, I was, you know, he's the best player in the football at that time and always will be in my mind. I was very fortunate because in my situation, like I said before, I was in New York for 3 years with the Giants, a year in Denver. I was playing wide receiver, fullback. And when I moved to tight end, we were very fortunate the next year to get Willie, because Willie stretched the field just like he was talking about. And then I was playing tight end, so it was easy for me to get away from linebacker because I had played wide receiver, and it was easy for me to release on bigger guys than it was the smaller guys. But then you throw in play action pass to Walter Payton. I mean, they'd fake that ball to Walter. Willie be running down the sideline, clearing it out, and I'm coming off the line and crossing the field, and I'd be wide open. I love playing tight end with these guys out there. Because you got to give Walter the respect. And they'd fake that ball to Walter and pull it out, and I'd release, and I'd be down the field crossing, and them guys would be turning around looking, going, oh, God, there he go. And I averaged almost close to 16 yards a catch in my career because of Walter Payton and Willie Gall doing what they do. So appreciate them guys.
Battery may have died. Switch out a mic here.
Hello. Okay. So my experience with Walter is a little bit different. I met Walter before I became a Bear. I actually met him at a charity event maybe a couple years before I became a Bear, so I knew him. And when I was drafted by the Bears, he was one of the first guys I called. He called me and congratulated me, which was great. And when I got there, my very first touchdown, people don't know that, was thrown to me by Walter Payton. Yeah, and actually, I caught my first touchdown. I caught three touchdowns at one day in New Orleans. Walter threw me one, Jim McMahon threw me one, and Walter threw me another one. So I had two touchdown passes from Walter Payton. So as a football player, I think no one can argue that he's probably the best to ever play. I mean, from a runner, blocker, passer, the way he worked, he was arguably the best player ever to play the game. Certainly at running back. And you probably don't know this, but Walter was a practical joker also. I mean, you always had your head on a swirl when you're around Walter because you never know what was going to happen. I mean, we'd go on the practice field, and all of a sudden, a firecracker or a missile would go off, and it's Walter. You know, he put Jock H powder in your jock, you know, or heat bomb in your underwear or something. It was just crazy. And he would hug you so tight because he was so strong, and he'd try to squeeze the breath out of you, which, you know, I'm a small guy, so that wasn't hard for him to do me like that. So, but yeah, Walter was a great player, great to play with. He worked amazingly. His work ethic was second to none, and just a tragic loss, and we really miss him, really miss that guy.
William? William, have anything? Walter? William.
Walter?
Walter?
Well, yeah, you know, I couldn't say too much about it. The guy was great, and he ran hard, and he blocked and everything else. He did everything. I mean, he was a great football player all the way around. And you couldn't say nothing about him because he was that good.
Yeah. Yeah. Test. Yeah, I mean, my experience, you know, obviously coming from a small black college, used to play against his school, so watched him a lot as a kid, just like you guys sitting here looking at us. That's how I was looking at him, and we was on the plane. When we fly, Walter sit the first row outside of first class, and he got those first three seats. So the rule of the thumb, no one sits with him, because if you sit with him, you get hurt. So I said, you know, I'm gonna sit with him. I gotta sit here and talk to this man because, you know, I've been watching him all these years. And clearly next week, you know, I tore my hamstring and hurt my ankle. So I was done for the whole preseason. But while I was sitting there, you know, just kind of getting off of meeting Walter, and he said, hey, I'm gonna actually show you a trick. I said, okay, what? So he had this deck of cards. He had been had it there for a while. They looked like beat up. And he said, you think I can tear this deck? I said, no, I don't think so. And he tore the deck in about 20 seconds. I looked and said, stewardess, give me another deck of cards, right? So the stewardess came back with a brand new deck, opened it up, I gave it to him, and it took him about 30 seconds longer, and he tore that deck. And I said, boy, at that point, you know, he was like God to me. You know what I mean? I mean, this guy is so strong, yet got the sweetest voice and the sweetest person you ever want to meet. But yet, when you're talking about hand strength that way, it's like, you know, I'm never going to get in your way. You're never going to have a problem with me. But, you know, I used to love watching him do his thing. I had a pass rush move where he'd kick his leg that I kind of equated into my game. And, you know, when we get in that huddle on the field, he would always say, don't do what I say, do what I do. And that means when he's on the field, watching him do his thing, you know, he may say, you see us at head hips, but yet, you know, if he's not doing it, you know, you don't do it. But the point of it is, watching him go to work is what, you know, you live for, to work at that level. Yeah, and that's what I try to do week in and week out, to compete and play at that level the way he played.
You know, these are all great things you're hearing about Walter, and it's tough to, you know, a format like this. It would take all night to sit here, and you could tell Walter Payton right. stories and what he meant to all of us. And he really took time, I think, personally, to get to know everybody on the team, which was something. And what I really appreciate about it, you know, I came into the Bears, you know, a nobody from nowhere, and when I made the team, Ray Early, who's the equipment guy at the time, put my locker next to Walter. So I lockered next to Walter for years, and that was a great experience. I mean, that was amazing. He razzed me so many times in the morning. There's some embarrassing stuff I can't even talk about, but it was all good fun. But the thing is, the way he would treat you as a teammate outside of Hallis Hall was special. The way he would come and focus on you, and I played in some Pro Bowls with him, and the way that he would still recognize me as his teammate there, and the way that personal relationship that we had would be stronger than any relationship he had over there in Hawaii, and he'd want to spend time with you over there too. It's just a huge loss he's not with us, but I mean the memories of what he was and how hard he worked and inspired, and just his attitude is the thing that I think inspired all of us. I mean, I remember when we were starting to make the playoffs, and you could just tell how much he wanted to win the playoffs. I remember one time he talked to the team. He was willing to give up all the money he made in the playoffs to divide it up amongst us, because that's all he wanted, the opportunity to get in the playoffs. And that's, I mean, I think we all maybe felt a little special thing that in the 85 year that, you know, we all wanted to win the Super Bowl for ourselves, of course, but in our heart. I mean, Walter, we all loved Walter Payton, no question about it.
You know, one thing about Walter is if you ever look at a picture of Walter outside of football, away from the facility, you look at every person in the background in the picture, they're all smiling. And, you know, Walter could walk into an elevator, and by the time that elevator stops, everybody's smiling and happy. There was a couple times, and Walter, I got to play with Walter for a couple years, but there's a couple times where he would drive down to Joliet and come and sit in my mom and dad's backyard. And I have some pictures of it. We have a photo album of it. And the kids from the neighborhood would all gather around his motorcycle, and they'd all be sitting on it, wearing his helmet. But every single person and every single picture in the background had a smile on their face. And he's so unlike the superstars of today, because they have an entourage, or they have an attitude where they almost make people uncomfortable. Walter Payton was the complete opposite. No matter what scenario he was in, he made everybody feel comfortable.
Number one on the list of the Bears' top 100 in your centennial scrapbook. Make sure you pick one up before the weekend is over. Outstanding publication. Number one on the list. We all agree. All right, let's roll some of those Super Bowl 20 highlights. How about it? Bears got their Super Bowl, and I don't even know where to begin, because you guys knew you were winning this damn game.
Highlights.
There was no doubt about it.
We knew we'd win if we didn't turn the ball over. Unfortunately, you know, that first series, we turned the ball over.
But when they have a minus 26 yards total offense at halftime, you sort of figure the game's almost over.
That one there went for, you didn't have to go but 20 yards in. But I mean, the first play to me when, we came in the game saying, hey, you know, let's shut these guys out. We played them before. We knew they didn't have much. We've shut two teams out, so we was like, let's go for it again. And obviously, Walter fumbled the ball. Some people got upset. It's your big catch there, Willie.
Right, that play right there, Willie. I remember McMahon in the huddle saying, hey, give it this one more second here. This could go for a long play. Yeah, I mean, he called it.
When he called it, I was like, okay, great, I'm ready.
That was the first play of the second half, but, I think.
Play of the second half.
Yeah, where was that 35-yard field position there, man? We were on the 2-yard line. How did that happen?
2-yard line, exactly.
Yeah.
Reggie Phillips.
But my play, I mean, you got that looks great. I mean, anyway, so we got to go out now to stop the guys from scoring.
Boom! Ooh,
that's a headache right there, folks, I promise you. So we got to knock these guys out. We can't let them score, because generally when the first one scored, they say normally win the Super Bowl. So, you know, people have been patting us on our back and telling us how great we were, and now you got to go on the field right away. So my first play, I get knocked on my ass, okay? I mean, I come off, they go play action, Holloway hits me in the chest, and I'm trying to not fall back on my back, I'm off balance, and I see him coming back to wipe me out. So I say, either you can hit reset or you let this man take you out. So, of course, you hit reset. And all I thought about was da-na-na, da-na-na. Being on TV, knocked on my ass, and I said, you know, hey, now you said, well, you know, you're playing the Super Bowl. Why would, you know, you need someone to strike? If you've never been there, you don't know, right? But the point of it is I had that opportunity to hit reset and became MVP.
That's great. Awesome. When they announced my name to run on the field, I couldn't hardly feel my feet hit the ground. I mean, because think about it, the magnitude of the Super Bowl. I grew up watching the Super Bowl.
Right.
I'm thinking to myself, oh my gosh, a billion people are watching me. So I was really like a nervous energy. I mean, it's hard to describe, but I was ready, but I was really gutsy inside. It's like such a huge feeling. But once I touched the ball for the first kickoff return, it all just became a normal game.
Right.
And it became just a regular game. But that first play was something that was really, because you don't want to make a mistake, but yet you know what you're doing, but because you're a professional, but yet you also know there's millions of people watching you. But then once you touch the ball, it's just another game.
When Fridge got into the backfield, whether it be San Francisco, Green Bay, the offensive lineman, we used to say, you better make a good block, because if you don't and William hits you in the back,
hit you in the back,
you're going to get hurt, you're going to get pushed out of the way, and it's going to look bad. So William was great in center for us when they did give him the ball to make a good block to get out of the way.
It's a big game, but the point of it is, you know, you don't make it more than what it is. It's the same game for higher stakes. You know, some people come out and they change their ways. When you do that, you just blink. It's over, okay? It's the same game you played throughout the year, but now it's just at higher levels.
Yeah, it's just like the Olympics, you know, it's the same thing.
Yeah, right. But see, Olympics, you gotta wait. You gotta wait.
The Olympics.
You gotta wait four years to get what? Exactly. 10 seconds to get it done, right? Same. Can't mess around.
Yeah, I think that, you know, playing in the Super Bowl, I was going into my ninth year, but we had already beat New England earlier that year. So we were pretty confident. And when the defense, when they tried to run the ball or pass the ball three times in a row, I think they knew that they knew they couldn't run the ball against our defense. And I remember years ago, probably about 10 years ago, I was at an event up in Canada, and Steve Grogan was there, who was the quarterback. And he said, Emory, he says, I'm still ducking from number 55 over there. He said, every time I see a bear, I'm ducking, he said.
Yeah,
I mean, well, I'll tell you, for me personally, I mean, the Super Bowl is probably, like a lot of these guys saying, it's still a football game. Yes, it's still football, but yet the hype around it makes it a huge, huge event. And everybody, when you're playing in an event like that, you want to put your best foot forward. And, you know, I was never shy in words. And they asked me, well, what do you think about are y'all going to win the Super Bowl? I said, yeah, we're going to win the Super Bowl, and we're going to shut them out if all of us stay healthy and play well together. And obviously, we see the outcome of it, 46-10. And, you know, Fridge get in there and do his thing. It was just a phenomenal event, and I enjoyed it. You know, Richard, he was MVP. And how many sacks did you have, Richard? Because I had like two sacks that game. You had what, three or four?
No, actually it's not that. I didn't know, you know, I thought going into the playoffs, you know, I had got three, four sacks at the first game.
Hey,
and three
Tom,
sacks
Tom,
seven
how many
game.
Great blocks timeout. Did you have in the Super Bowl?
Everyone.
Yeah, we were dominating.
They don't count
Willie
those blocks.
Willie had 129 yards receiving and a touchdown.
Record the
well,
time.
It wasn't sacks, it's turnovers.
Emory, you had a good catch in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, he got a tip.
Jim Morrissey had the longest interception return in the Super Bowl that didn't result in a touchdown.
Hey.
These guys were all great. They were all great players.
How many times I was outside?
Give it up for these guys. They were all great. They all contributed.
Hey, Jay. Hey. Once again, y'all had the ball on the 35-yard line.
That's what I was about to say. You know? So they run the ball at me the first turnover, and I'm like, Craig James or whoever the kid. I'm like,
they were all afraid.
I mean, I'm like, what is this that they're running? I'm like, this is disrespectful. You to run this? And, you know, don't get it wrong. I'm like, it's not often you see a white guy playing tailback, okay, in the National Football League. You just don't see that often. And I'm looking at him. He's looking at me. I just reached in and I said, give me that ball, man. You don't know what you're doing. And y'all get the ball on 20-yard line. You score a touchdown.
That's
Matt
right,
Suet.
Sure.
All right?
You know, a lot of times people talk about, you know, Walter, why didn't Walter score in that game? And this game, it got out of hand so fast. I mean, at halftime, we knew the game was over. With 6 minutes in the third quarter, all the starters on offense are already on the bench. Reggie Phillips intercepts a pass and runs it back. Jim Morrissey runs it back. Hayseed picks up a fumble for a safety. The game got out of control so fast that game, and we were just so ready to play our very best game. And, you know, I just, you know, Walter should have got a touchdown, but I'm telling you, everybody was playing their butt off that day. And sometimes you got to be a decoy. And they wanted to stop Walter. That's their main plan on our offense, was to stop Walter. But everybody else stepped up. Just like Richard says about the team, our offense stood up, the special team stood up, the defense stood up, and that's how we played a great game that day.
And we wanted to make the city of Chicago happy and having a lot of fun early. We wanted to get your party started at halftime. You don't have to wait, baby. It was on.
Well, think about it. Think about it. Okay, okay, think about this one thing for 1 second. Joe Namath predicted they were going to win the Super Bowl at the Super Bowl. We predicted we were going to be in the Super Bowl in game number 3 of that year because we made the Super Bowl shuffle in game number 3, right? So that's the best prediction that came true ever. Game number 3, we made the Super Bowl shuffle, and we won the Super Bowl. So.
That don't happen often, folks, I promise.
Yeah, but it was the offensive line that did the black and blues poster first.
Tell us about that. What's
we
up
were
with
first.
That?
We were number that? One. We started it off, the old line.
You're right.
Yeah, the black and blues brothers.
Looking cool like that. That was fun.
We signed a million of those things, haven't we, Tom?
That's right. I got a few still in there.
And how, you know, the other thing you autograph all the time is the game.
The Bobble Doll
program? The program, yeah. The program. The game you autograph. You know, the Superdome holds 80,000, something like that. I know I've signed over 100,000 programs of the Super Bowl. I mean, shoot.
All right, we have just a couple of minutes to go, so we'll take a couple of fan questions. This is from Chris. Thanks for coming from Oxford, England.
All right.
England.
Bears are headed there. Bears will be headed. Where are you? There you go. Properly wearing 34. He wants you guys to put into words what it felt like to step out on Soldier Field on Sundays, all these home games in that era of Bears football, what it was like to be playing in front of those fans at Soldier Field.
Well, it's no doubt about it. It's an honor and a pleasure, you know, to play in Soldier Field, and because of the history, you know, of Soldier Field and just the history of the organization itself, the oldest organization, and to wear that uniform with pride and, you know, having guys like this, it's a lot of pressure. Because if you don't play, you're going to pretty much be embarrassed because somebody else is going to do something special.
Right, yeah. And for me, you know, I would love to play in the stadium today because, you know, you can hear the noise. But when we was playing, the noise was just go away so fast. But to watch Walter step out of the huddle and start clapping, and the whole stand started clapping, it was just magical. I said, shit, I want that kind of power, you know. I wanted to be like that, you know. So to have the people to respond like that to him, you know, it just tells it tells the players how much, you know, the people appreciate the game itself here in Chicago.
And think about it. We get an opportunity to play for an amazing city like Chicago. We get a chance to play for an owner who helped create the league. And there's rich tradition there. And then to be able to play with guys like this, to run on Soldier Field, and to make touchdowns, and to win games, and to bring a championship back to Chicago was really a special, something that I'll always carry with me no matter where I go, no matter what I do for the rest of my life. So it's great.
Anybody else?
It's just, you know, coming into Chicago and playing in front of great fans like Chicago, playing for the Chicago Bears, you know, George Halas, just all that. And on top of it, to win the Super Bowl, and to win the championship, and the interaction we had with the crowds. I mean, it's a special time in our life. It's the biggest moment in all of our lives.
Yeah, you know, when I came from Evanston, so I grew up watching Gale Sayers and Dick Butkus. So when I got a chance to play for the Bears, I knew the history. I knew a little bit of history, but one of the great things that they did in the early 80s is George Halas put the book Halas by Halas in every player's hands when they came to the Chicago Bears. So you could read about the history of the Bears, the history of the league, how it struggled early, and I think that's something that's missing today. People don't know the history. The players don't know the history of their teams, of the leagues, and I thought that was just a phenomenal thing. Even though I thought I knew the Bears, I didn't know the Bears till I read the book. And I think every player that plays for the Bears should learn the history of the Chicago Bears.
Otis, before you go, I can say that, you know, one moment that was really special in my heart at Soldier Field is when we won the championship game, or actually Wilbur Marshall was running the touchdown, and I'm looking at Fred swinging his arm up and down. I'm looking at that dark gap in between his mouth. You probably don't remember that, Fridge. I don't know. But yet, seeing him and looking at you, Otis, the celebration, how the fans, the championship game to me, was more important than the Super Bowl. It was, it's something that stick. The championship game is something that I would always remember more so than the Super Bowl in Chicago.
All right. Willie? Oh,
yes.
NFC Championship game.
Yes.
Here are some of the highlights. We're going to be wrapping up here any second, but it was a total demolition. Total demolition in every way, shape, and form. Huh?
Emery running downfield there.
Yeah, I had legs back then.
It was so amazing because this is a touchdown, which was a great throw by Jim, and I was just in the back corner of the end zone.
Twinkle toes, look at that.
Got it started. And after the last play, it started to snow.
Yep.
Right, and that's the
really
icing came
so
on.
Poetic. It was poetic justice. I also have to say, I was really impressed. When we got back the day after the Super Bowl, I think there was 25 or 35,000 fans in below zero weather to greet us for a parade, which was amazing. So where else can you go to find that type of support than Chicago?
Here's the play. Yeah. Here's the play. Yeah. Fridge, your pitch is coming up, and Otis, yours coming up here too. Yes, this is with the snow coming down, putting the icing on the cake in Chicago, making it happen.
Hey, I just wanted you guys to score because I didn't want to go out and run more plays.
I told you. We told you, just hold them, we'll come back and score. You remember that? No.
All right, before we wrap it up, since it's a top 40 hit, a little Super Bowl shuffle, Willie.
Oh, Willie got the chocolate swirl.
Willie,
get that line, Willie.
And then we're wrapping up. Okay, send us off,
Speedy,
my friend.
Willie, and I'm world class. I like running, but I love to catch a pass. I practice all day and dance all night. I got to get ready for the Sunday fight. Now, I'm as smooth as a chocolate swirl. I dance a little funky, so
watch me, girl.
There's no one here that doesn't like me. My Super Bowl shuffle shall set you free.
A mama's boy, Otis, one of a kind. The ladies all love me from my body and my mind. I'm slick on the floor.
They call me sweetness.
But ain't
they
no sucker gonna get past
like
me.
Run the ball like making romance. We had the ball since training camp to give Chicago a Super Bowl champ. Now, we're not doing this because we're greedy. The Bears are doing it to feed the needy. I didn't come here looking for trouble. I just came here to do the Super Bowl show.
Yeah, all right.
You're looking at the
champions.
I'm the rookie. I may be large, but I'm no dumb cookie. You see me hit. You see me run, but catch a bag.
I'm a rookie. I may be large, but I'm no dumb cookie. You see me hit. You see me run. When I kick and pass, I have more fun. I can dance. You will see. They all learn from me. I didn't come here looking for trouble. I just came through the Super Bowl.